All right. We are going to do Lazy Guru Day Co-satsangs, which means I'm going to select these reaction videos where people listen to songs and say, oh my gosh, these older songs aren't that bad. And some of them aren't. You guys are just lucky because all the crappy ones aren't listened to much anymore. So we're gonna do that. I'm gonna listen to these satsangs, and I'm gonna have a live reaction. There, now you should eat my salad. Yes, did you want to ask a question, Richard Tate?
Yeah. On the reason that I had posted the ones on the pain body were, you know, Jill and I had been talking about, you know, the inner child, how to get more in contact with that. And she had pointed out to me that I really hadn't gotten in touch with the pain body itself.
Yeah.
And that it might be a more effective thing to watch for that.
Okay.
And so I was, you know, I was looking at, you know, the difference between, you know, ego, pain body, and then, you know, the inner child work.
Okay.
And what, you know, it's like, what is the difference between the pain body, or is there a difference between the pain body and the inner child work?
Okay. Well, I can answer that before watching the video, if you like.
Yeah, that's fine.
The pain body actually consists of a present moment experience that's comprised of four parts. One of those four parts is an old inner child triggered reaction. So Eckhart Tolle likes to point out that you know you're in a pain body if, say, the response to stimulus X should be about a level 2, but you're responding at level 8. He says that difference is something. And he says it's old unresolved pain. Old unresolved pain I have turned into the term inner child work, because mostly that's what you've found, is a child who's, or younger version of self, who has not been able to complete the full 90 seconds response. Because that's an emotional state when it's run its full course from beginning to end, takes 90 seconds. And if you weren't allowed, and most children aren't allowed, the full 90 seconds, you know, a 90 second so-called tantrum is something that almost no modern parent would allow. I don't know if there are cultures that were ever wise enough to let the child have its full response. I imagine they're probably, the closer you get to, you know, tribal, the closer that's probably, you know, happened. Because most parents don't have the emotional capacity to endure 90 seconds of a natural response of a child. So it's actually the parent that somehow stops it. You can see it by a child being cheered up or told to, you know, shut up, you'll get something worse, shit like that. So the inner child is one of the four components. The other three components are the current emotional state, which is separate from the inner child, which is why when Eckhart says it should be a 2, but it's an 8, he does give you the 2. You have responded to some stimulus in the present moment. And that does create an emotional state. So there is an emotional state running. Then there's probably some story running. They did this to me. If only, you know, she had been nicer to me, I would have been happier. If only he had done this. If only they had done that. There's some story. Or some old triggered story, like, yep, see, this happens all the time. Yep, this happens to me. This always happens to me. Or, oh, I guess this is proof that I was never loved by anybody. And some of these stories are so old and have so run so many times that they don't even feel like stories. They just feel like truth. I can tell the ones that the students don't want touched, because the moment I lean into them, they're hedging and falling asleep during the satsang and changing the subject. Or, let's get on. They don't want that thing touched. Those are the really old ones that they've built an identity out of. So the story, the emotional state, and the inner child, which is a triggered memory, which Richard Davison says that you get it everything. You get the smell, you get the taste, you get the sight, the sound, all these things come up, and you get the emotional state. Unfortunately, you get it all. And then this is because Jill Poldy Taylor's point that we are, you know, feeling creatures that think. You get the feeling, and then something thinks about the feeling. Well, the story is the get rid of the think about the feeling crap. This noble human response of being able to think is actually the downfall of humanity, because they believe the nonsense they think. So the last little bit, the fourth one, and this is the one that's the hardest to find, is that there is a brain mechanism, a specific part of the brain. Usually it's the itty bitty shitty committee that Joe Bolte Taylor talks about. It likes to tell doom and gloom and stories. It'll never work. It'll never be happy. This will always feel this way. It gets paid. I called it, you know, the negative evaluation center. Its job is to take the negative, the naysaying evaluation of whatever it is that you're experiencing. You know, you're in a business meeting and nine people are going, yes, it's a great idea. And one person's going, I don't think that's such a good idea. This is actually what you want in a business meeting, is if they're all licking the boss's butt, then the boss had better be right. So you actually want this component, but you don't want this component to run your life. So the problem is that it is perfectly fine with our depression, our anxiety, our misery, because it's just a bunch of cells that is getting rewarded. And so if we don't find this thing and hold it accountable and find out what it does, then we will be constantly at its mercy. So those are the four components to a pain body. Pain body has all four. Only one of those components is the inner child. Now, this is what I found when I went in to look for it, because Eckhart basically gives you the pain body. He's got a lot of amazing talks on the pain body. But when I went in to look at my pain body, I found all of those components, and that's why I broke it down into those four parts. And I can find them. The only one that may not be present is a specific memory from a child. There might just be an old feeling that comes up, like, this again. And it might not be that time that my, you know, brother pooped on my head. Unless you're going to
Are that. These written down in any of the books?
Yes. Yeah, the breaking down of the pain body. I want to say it's in Accept What Is.
Breaking down of the pain body.
A breakdown of the pain body, I think it's called. Oh, boy. I want to say it's Accept What Is. Let me check and see if it is Accept What Is. A breakdown of the pain body or something like that. I know, that's your thing. Actually, it looks like it might be in the most recent.
Okay.
Because this has got a pain body section, but So it's going to be in the most recent one, which is called something something.
Have you suffered enough?
Yes, have you suffered enough? I can't remember these books. They're written by some doofus. There we are. Ooh, I like the art on this book.
Yeah, nice. Here we go.
It's got a large pain body section. A breakdown of the pain body, something like this. There it is. A breakdown of the pain body and how to transmute it into peace. According to this, it's page 137, and I think this is accurate.
Yeah.
And
okay.
I also made a little guided meditation that I believe is on YouTube. And as Al has pointed out, I switched around the orders in the guided meditation than in the book. That's because, well, I won't go into detail about that. So that the inner child is only one of the four components of a pain body attack.
Okay?
Yeah. All right.
Okay. Yeah, I've just been kind of observing just the pain body.
Period. Yes.
When it comes up, and then just to develop that habit.
I did not master the pain body until I broke it into those four parts. Because the pain body, as a pain body attack, can be rather disorienting and, you know, disabling. And usually when I started this work, I could only do work on the pain body after the attack. And so mastery really has to involve getting to the point while you're doing it during the attack. And if you're doing it during the attack, you really have to know what you're looking at. And so I sat and knowing what I knew about neuroscience, what I knew about all these various things, I tried to find the component parts. And this is what I found. And the interesting thing is it's a lot like the Buddhist practice of breaking down physical pain, where you can say, well, that's a binding sensation, and that's a you know, this sensation, and that sensation, so that you can kind of pull back when you break this down into its four component parts, and it has a weakened impact on you. Mm-hmm. When you come in to observe it, now that's true of pretty much anything, right? Which is why mindfulness is impactful. It's also why mindfulness is the basis of almost all meditation. But the fact that if you can move back and you can look and you can find these component parts, well then you can depersonalize this quite a bit. And a lot of people would like, if the pain body as it's offered up, it's offered up kind of as a villain, right? And I wanted people to see that there's something extremely precious in here, because a lot of the students that I work with that just really just refused and ultimately even left felt like I was dismissing that inner child and what that inner child had gone through. And that their liberation would be the abandonment of that little child's pain or misery or experience or story. A lot of people don't like that first part, drop the story. Because the story that I've been done to, boy, that's a good one. I've built an entire identity out of that and I don't want it touched. So if the story is, oh, here it is again, well, a lot of people don't want to drop that story. An entire identity has been built around, this has been done to me. And so even the first part of the suggested, you know, four parts of deconstructing, which is drop the story, is a threat to my entire identity. And feels like I'm being whatever. What am I trying to say here? That disloyal to this child, to something. And when I was looking for what the thing was that I was being disloyal to, I found the inner child. So that's why when I deconstruct the pain body, I move the inner child out of the deconstruction. Everything else can be met with a critical eye. Is the story true? Is this brain mechanic really here to help me? The fact that it says no, 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 is it really useful? Is it useful now? We know that there are times when saying no is useful, but is some habitual no useful? Is it useful now? Because that brain mechanic, as it turns out, this is the problem that when I looked into neuroscience and brain science and I started noticing that these clusters of cells don't have a conscience or a sense of empathy for what they're doing, even empathy cells. It's not like they're empathic. They generate a sense of empathy in us, but they're not. That these clusters of cells are really just networks that have a reward for growing. The neural net grows. Through Hebb's law, it gets associated with other neural nets. And they function on their own. The reason why we are an adaptive species is because of this specific way the brain wires. We're adaptive to different environments that have different needs. And without that, we wouldn't be where we are. With it, though, which I have a lot of artists among my my students, there'd be a very limited canvas, but there's no limitation now. Now, you can make, I know this from filmmaking, you can make a happy movie, or you can make a horror movie, and there's nothing stopping you from doing either one. I'm not saying horror movies are bad or whatever, I'm just saying I wouldn't want to live in one. They're highly entertaining.
One thing that I've seen is that I almost don't even notice when, like, a negative feeling comes in or something like that because it's so habitual.
That's exactly the case. But in that habit, and I'm fine that this is what this satsang has turned into. I hope everyone else is. But in that habit, you're going to find Rick Tate. And the story is Rick Tate is the one that feels this way. That's the story. Now, how real does that story feel? So if I asked you to drop that story, how motivated would you be to do that? You see this, teachers do this all the time, right? Skillful teachers, better than me, of course, because I'm Kmart, but you see Ajah says things like, just for a second, drop the story that I'm the one who feels that way all the time. Just for the hell of it. And tell me how you feel. And some people have said to me, I can't. And I hate to say this, and I can see a lot of students that I've said this to on the screen right now. It's really, I won't. It's never really, I can't. I could give you one little to the head, just two or three places, you'll forget all of it. Little stroke in the right places, you'll forget all of it. It's I won't. Now in Zen, this is where they would say you lack the courage. And then, you know, it's funny that that word, especially in this culture of machismo, sounds like a shaming. And in Zen, they're just pointing it out. They literally are just saying, you lack the courage. Not, you should find it. They're just mentioning that the courage to drop this story is apparently so terrifying that you're incapable of doing it now. Just as if somebody put a parachute on me and put me right at the edge of the airplane, I would lack the courage to jump out. And then the next person says, excuse me, and just jumps out. You say, wow, what courage? And they say, it's not courage. It's boredom. I've jumped out 1,000 times. So it really does, it begs the question in Zen when they're asking that, what is courage? Mm-hmm. And courage is direct knowledge that you can survive it, which is why you can't, most people can't enlighten. Because they have no direct knowledge they can survive it, right? Well, it helps to be suicidal, which is why I call my way the coward's way, because I was already willing to give up this life. So when I gave up my ego, it wasn't frightening. But if there's something to defend, we're not going to give it up. And if there's something that we feel is precious and worth defending, like an inner child, we're not going to abandon that inner child. And then in some cases, some of these stories are linked to parents. See, oftentimes first children get to commingle their pain bodies with their I won't say father anymore. I'll say strongest willed parent, because there are people whose mothers are the strongest willed parent. And some, of course, families have two mothers and two fathers, etc. So whatever the strongest personality of the two is, that's usually what the first child is aligned to. And historically, it's been male, so that's why it was stated that the father usually, I mean, he even skillfully says usually in his book on the family. This, by the way, for anyone listening, John Bradshaw, The Family, where I was introduced to the idea of inner children. It's now common parlance in you know, psychotherapy. Well, what that really is how do we deal with old triggered memories that have all the components in it Richard Davidson was talking about? What do we do with the fact that I'm sitting, eating my salad, and all of a sudden I'm in this emotional state because some random thing happened? And then you'll get people with phobic personalities who can tell you, oh, it's the color green, or it's the sound, you know, that birds make when they poop. And that's great. If you can identify it, that's lovely. Now find out what the hell it is and heal it. So that is the next step with, I'm finding that I always feel this way. You know, one of my students in the satsang said to me once, I always wake up with a tight stomach. And I said, really? I don't. If I'm always walking around with a tight stomach, then my stomach is not technically tight. Not in my experience. It's just the way my stomach is. And so if you have a satori, a real break, a real shift where everything relaxes and everything stops, this is why the mind immediately calls it a spiritual state. It's not my state. My state is the normal tight stomach, whatever. And this is not useful. This is not a useful story and identity, because it will fulfill itself. So all of these components, the biggest one and the reason why it's first, is this story. I am this person. I'm a person. I'm high strung. I'm a kind of a sad person. No, you're not. You're neither one of those things. And that's extremely challenging to people. The biggest one, and that's why I wrote this piece, is that I'm a victim of something. That's the one that if somebody's got that, almost you can't get their fingers off of that. The death grip on I'm a victim of something is, that's a big one. But if you can find a child who was, which is, you know, like the bit we did about the inconsolable one, this is why they're not buying this spiritual mumbo-jumbo bullshit. Because I'm telling them they're not a victim. And I mean, you're not a victim now. I don't mean you've never been victimized in the relative experience. I was stabbed in the chest with someone who did that with the intent to kill me. I had no problem whatsoever saying that in that moment I was victimized by that human being. I can say it's not happening now. This is why I absolutely cannot stand these bullshit psychobabble terms like rape survivor. I fucking hate those terms. But I get what they're doing. They're trying to change rape victim to rape survivor. I get it. Neither one of those things are fucking important. It's one incident in your life. Don't make an identity out of it. Now, the same is true even of an entire childhood's worth of experiences. If I'm a victim of my childhood, well, you're not in your childhood anymore. It's not happening now. In many cases with the people I'm working with, the perpetrators are dead. See, but then people will say, but not the culture that created them and not the toxic masculinity or the... I say, yeah, sure. Well, then I'll be a victim of that. Okay. Not now. But if you've got this perfect movie theater that we have in the front of our head called the frontal lobe, and we can create a little fake person and stick it in that movie theater and have it relive the same horrible nightmares over and over and over, well, then that can be our constant experience. And we're capable of that. Now, in the talk that I plan on having one day unless I die or retire.
Almost happened this week.
Yeah. I'm going to discuss what's called default mode in the brain. And in default mode in the brain, it's usually, it happens during our, quote, downtime. There's a lot of selfing that happens in the default mode. This is where we go through everything and catalog it and pick out things and examine it and weigh it and look at it. And it's all about ourselves. Now, this is also where creativity happens, which is another cool TED talk, which wasn't mentioned in the book, but there's a TED talk on default mode and creativity and how constantly avoiding default mode, which is why we watch TV, do anything but default mode. We don't want default mode. We don't want to be in default mode because it's very uncomfortable to go through the catalog of me. Well, so people keep busy, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Basically, we're avoiding default mode on a fairly constant basis. Well, the problem is that if you ever mistake the little character in default mode for you, then default mode kind of stops functioning the way it's supposed to. It's supposed to be kind of a, here's the notes, of the previous business meeting. It's supposed to be a useful kind of little reminder and reassessment period for an animal that isn't supposed to have all this protected time. Because, I saw a video where a guy was jogging blissfully, a human, and a cougar showed up. And the human in modern times had absolutely no idea of what to do. Well, back before all this fortresses we lived in, you had to be a little bit more aware of your environment. You couldn't be in default mode as much as we are. But we have refrigerators full of food, and we have these huge fortresses, and so we have a lot of time for default mode. And one of the things we do in this default mode is run our story of us. And that story of me then becomes me. And that story of me is not me. So what is happening in this now moment, in direct experience, almost no one knows. So if I get this triggered response that triggers an old pain, it's very confident to say then, this has always happened to me. Because it's old, right? Then it seems, especially if I'm going to do my little default mode cataloging of what is and isn't true, it seems pretty reasonable to say, I'm the type of person who has this response. And be very happy with all these conclusions we've drawn and all these evaluations we've made of me. And then as I've written many times, you have to be perfectly safe and have plenty of time to be doing this. Because if you watch the video of the guy and the cougar, he didn't stop and ruminate. He didn't. He had one moment where he said, oh, I guess this is where I'm going to die. He did say that. But it's just a passing he's noticing. and it didn't kill him. It finally gave up pursuing him. mostly because he reached down to grab a rock. He had the entire video ended with him. He was so tired of backing away from this cougar that he said, "Okay, I guess this is where we fight." And he reached down to grab a rock. The second his demeanor changed, the cat ran. Because the cat didn't want to fight. Wouldn't mind pursuing him as long as he looked like food running away. But the moment it was a fight, the cat didn't want to fight. Because the cat's present. I'm talking about on a dime, the cougar turned. The cat is in the now. The cat is actually having this actual interaction. The person was going in and out of their head, which was fascinating to watch. But during that, they're not sitting around ruminating. It would have been a great video if in the middle of the cougar pursuing him, he said, "Oh, I'm always me. I'm the one who gets pursued by a cougar again." Ooh. Would have been a fantastic video. But he doesn't have time for that. He's too busy dealing with whether or not this cougar is going to kill him. So my point that I'm making is that the only time we have time for rumination is when we are actually safe in the present moment. Which is proof that it's bullshit. That alone is proof that anything you're ruminating about is crap. That's why Eckhart is, now we could change it to, the panther actually is a cougar. I think that some of these are interchangeable, these words. I think this is a panther in the room. He's pretty confident that if you're ruminating, there isn't. Some of us spiritual teachers are rather tricky because we know the answer before we ask the question. So if I'm sitting around thinking about, well, always me, I've always been this, da, 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 I usually have to be pretty safe to be doing this. Pretty safe to feel like shit. By definition, I have to be whole and perfect to feel that horrible. Because again, if I was unhealthy, if I was dealing, when I had my kidney stones, I wasn't sitting around going, "Oh, that time that my father treated me poorly." No, I was going, "Oh, mother flound, this is killing me." So you have to pretty much be whole and in good health, doing quite well, to be ruminating about how horrible your life is. And this irony is not lost on me as a student when I was looking. I was like, wow, this is interesting. I kind of, because someone said something in a chat room once. It was like, and I've seen this many times said in a certain way. It's like, Eckhart Tolle is for rich people. And they're kind of right. And most Americans don't know that they're rich people. I mean, they have no clue how wealthy they are, right? So, and this is because rich people have a lot of time for what I was talking about, default mode. In that default mode, when you're evaluating your life, you can come to the conclusion that this has always happened to me. And then you believe it. Well, that story is one of the four components. And that story feels like, when I'm giving it up, I'm abandoning a child who actually had that experience. Because it did happen to that child. That's why I say when the child arises, you validate them. The answer is yes to the child. No to you. Meaning no to this fake identity you've made out of it. That actually, funny enough, it's kind of like, okay, you've heard the term enabler, yes? Simplistic version is someone's an alcoholic. Somebody enables them to be an alcoholic. It's very hard to find a really hardcore alcoholic, like dysfunctional. The one that even normal grade alcoholics call alcoholics. You know, because normal grade alcoholics are like, I don't get drunk until it's 5 p.m., so I'm not an alcoholic, right? I can still hold a job, therefore I'm not an alcoholic. No, you're an alcoholic. But the ones that are completely dysfunctional, that are just swimming in booze, can really only do that if something enables them to do that. And that is what people in the psychology profession call an enabler. Well, interestingly enough, when we don this artificial bullshit persona that I am that particular broken one, we are enabling the child to never heal. We're keeping that child locked in that unresolved pain. For me, for an identity. So I can be something. So when people ask me, I love when, I almost said Richard. I love when Eckhart's doing his satsangs and he says, I want to tell you my story. I want to tell you. Let me tell you. Let me tell you about it. People love this. And interestingly enough, there's something in them that is getting off on this. This narcissistic idea that I have a story of me and it's as the downtrodden one and they don't want to give it up. And so in order to do that, they are now keeping that child locked in that miserable state. And then I would say this, which is true, because the guy who stabbed me once. My brain in PTS dreams and ruminations stabbed me thousands of times. I'd rather hang out with the guy who stabbed me than my own brain. And if I became that guy who had been stabbed, let me tell you about it. Oh, yep, there it goes. That waiter looked at me funny when I asked him to change my order. He's probably, it's emotional violence. All I get is violence. Did I tell you that time I got stabbed? That means that I get to be literally locked in that moment of being stabbed. Forever. Now, I don't know how old I was, 20-something. But when it's 5, and you add in the powerlessness that comes with childhood, and you never let this child heal because you're busy using that child as some artificial persona, then shame on you. Because in my case, my dad is dead. I don't live with my mother. She's alive, but I don't live with her. I'm not around her all day. So if I'm committing the same sorts of crimes on myself in order to maintain a persona, then shame on me. Which is why I said it during the Inconsolable One teaching that the Inconsolable One is onto this bullshit. The Inconsolable One knows now who's keeping it in that cage. And knows it's you. So not fuck them, fuck you. Just so I can maintain my I've been done to persona. I have to keep that child in the victim state. Just so I have something to talk about at parties. I'm not kidding, it's that trivial. So that I'll have a status when I'm discussing who I am with some other person. You tell me your story. No, wait, I'll tell you my story. This is literally the standard egoic conversation. Two people not listening to one another, just waiting for their chance to tell their story. And you don't want to have nothing to say at the cocktail party. So if you let that child heal, you'd have nothing to say. Let me tell you, I don't have much to say at cocktail parties anymore. I really don't. I've told this story before about when I first moved out after doing the work and Jill took me to Cecile's dad's birthday party. And I couldn't even have fucking party conversation because the woman said, "What do you do?" And I had no response. What do you do? Nothing. No, that's cute. No, what do you do? She just wouldn't let it go. I had no story of me. Because they all just felt wrong. Artificial bullshit. And I actually loved the woman enough not to lie to her. Which is interesting because she didn't feel that way. She felt like I was not playing the accepted game, which is you tell me your story so that... And really, I don't give a fuck about your story. I just want you to be done so I can tell you mine. And that didn't happen. So she was getting pissed. And Jill saved me. Thank you, Jill. I had nothing. And not only was my status reduced, and I didn't give a shit because I was done with status, which is, again, if you're courageous enough to be done with status and you find out how lovely it is to have no status, Brian D., then you can say, I haven't really lost anything. And trust me, when the hyper-competitive ones are looking for someone to crush and you're too small to waste time on, this is a blessing. The type A personalities are walking around, let me prove myself to you, and they just pass you by. This is a good day. But there's a terror that you'll just be crushed under the weight of this absence of status. Status is fake. Why does the king need someone to, you know, taste their food? If the king had actual status, if the status actually protected them, they wouldn't need the person to be tasting their food. They wouldn't need to walk around with guards. This is fake. So when you look into these things and you find you don't need them, then maybe you don't need the story. Maybe you don't need the story at the dinner party. And if you don't need the story at the dinner party, then you don't need to hold that child in the state that generates the story. And you can let that child heal. You can become an extremely boring person. Because I wrote once a piece called Dark Is Not Deep. Because for some reason, Americans just love depressives. Sylvia Plath and fucking the guy who wrote Old Man in the Sea. Why is his name just left me right now? They love these people who shoot them. Yeah, Hemingway. They love these people who shoot themselves. Because they're deep. These are deep people. They feel deeply. No, they don't. That's not deep. It's actually quite shallow. You think you got problems? I'll tell you my problems. It's a status. Doesn't seem to be. But when you look at it, it's the sad dinner party status. I'm the biggest victim in the room. Well, in order for that to be, you basically have to become the new tormentor of your inner child. So don't be so enamored with your story. Because it's just a method to keep that child where they are. A tool for you at dinner parties. Okay? Okay. Does that answer any of your questions? We went on a bit of an odyssey there. Well, we still have an hour and a couple of 9-minute videos to watch. So I'm going to assume that that answers what you were after in your video, Rick. And I'm going to go on to the other two videos. And if I have time, I'll watch yours. But I'm going to assume, hopefully, that that answers it. Would that be okay? You're nodding. Okay. Now, where the hell are these other videos? Okay, I can get rid of that thing. Slackadoo. Oh, by the way, Al, I went and reread this Don't Take Anything Personally, and I found a typo. Oh, boy.
No.
No.
Satsang's given.
Yeah. Okay. So that would be the first one. Good. By the way, if you guys are interested in the video that Rick said provoked this, it's called The Pain Body, The Hidden Secret Behind Self-Realization, and the chat is, I'm assuming, with Kim Ng. Now, Kim Ng is not someone I consider to be a master, just so everybody, but she does live with one, and I imagine a lot of osmosis happens, so she may have something extremely useful to say. A Course in Miracles. Joy eludes the mind that believes it's in this world is what we're going to be looking at. Now, in order to do this, first let me get this thing up. And I need to share the screen, right? I will do this one day. Maybe I'll put it over there. There we go. And, oh, this is so exciting. I did this last time. You have to share, sound too, which is something, right? Okay, can you guys all see that? Why do I believe I have to share sound? I'm going to start this and tell me if you guys hear anything. You hear music or... Ah, boy. Stop sharing. I'm not sharing anymore with you guys. Computer sound. There we go. Now this is going to be special. Yes? Oh, this is good. Okay, don't know who this bald dude is.
It's
I don't listen to bald dudes. They never know what they're talking about. Yeah, you're upset because it said in the description. I'm going to find out. Hold on. David Hoffmeister. He's a Meister of Hoff, whatever Hoff is. All right. We are going to listen to, apparently this is from The Course in Miracles. What I learned from reading The Course in Miracles was that nothing real can be harmed. That was my takeaway from it. I really liked it. Okay, here we go. I will accept atonement for myself, is what it's called.
Where everyone comes to this world, all who come to this world come for death and sorrow. That's the definition of coming. You can call it whatever you want, incarnation or arriving in a hologram or holding on to a hologram, but it's all who come for one purpose. And that's death and sorrow. And their joys are so fleeting that they cannot be possessed, nor even grasped. Nor even grasped. You might think of fingers just trying to get a whisk of joy. And joy eludes the mind that believes it's in this world. You know, all these compromised ideas that as long as you're still here, you're not enlightened, and so forth. What Jesus says in his manual for teacher, he says that there is one teacher needed to save the world, and that one is not a body or in a body. Mm-hmm. He makes it very clear, the distinction of who is the savior of the world. That's why when people say, you have to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, or Jesus Christ is my personal savior, that doesn't cut it. It doesn't cut it, because the Christ is not a body or in a body. It's a symbol that's being used. And Christian would say today how grateful she is for the symbol, because it's like the Holy Spirit doesn't take a form. The Holy Spirit is literally, like, we can't see the wind. The Holy Spirit is really unmanifest. And Jesus seemed to be, of all the cosmic images, he seemed to be an image that was a reflection of the Holy Spirit. Even though the Holy Spirit, Jesus says, you cannot, the Word of God was made flesh. Strictly speaking, Jesus says in the Course, this is impossible. Because the Word is Spirit. And the Word can never be made flesh. And where they're ready, you might have heard it referred to, there's no mind and matter, there's no life, truth, substance, intelligence. So I think what a glorious opportunity we have today to go beyond the tiny instant to the experience.
Now, before he goes on, I want to say that if the Course in Miracles wasn't written by Jesus, it wouldn't fucking matter. My books being written by me don't matter. The only thing that matters is the direct truth and the insight that you gain from any of this crap. You know, and as baby got to see when I was high as motherfucking hell on 5 grams of dried mushrooms, because I wanted to tell people whether or not they should take it. The body mind that you call, and of course Matthew knows because I peed on him. The body mind that you call Mark Pifer is of no use to you whatsoever, because it was absolutely gone. So, what he's talking about, that the iconic Jesus is of no use, is absolutely correct. If any teacher is an icon, then it's useless. There is a mild use as an icon of a teacher in a bhakti practice, and the same use of an iconic god in a bhakti practice, bhakti being surrender. It's extremely useful if you don't believe it. Like, I know for a fact that my teacher Richard poops, pees, and cries at you know, sad movies. But I can use my devotion to the teaching he gave me as a bhakti practice. To the teaching. I adore the man. But the teaching is it. And this is basically what he's talking about.
It's a joy to, again, you know, look at anything that seems to be an obstacle to the awareness of love's presence, or an attachment, or something in form that seems valuable. Because any of those things mean the same thing. Anything that's valued in and of itself in this world. Even that fly that's going around, has been going around for the last 2 days, he's joining us. Anything that is seen in and of itself or valued in and of itself is, by definition, an idol made to take the place of the living Christ. And so that's what our joy is, living the experience of being free of attachments, free of ambitions, free of pursuits, free of reciprocity, free of exchange, free of I'll scratch your back if you scratch my back, free of bargains, free of...
I can tell you right now that while this teaching is accurate, it's being heard of, free is being replaced with a void. Avoid attachments, avoid bargains, avoid life, blah, 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 blah. And as I'm listening to this, even though this is a teaching that's been around for a long time, and I really like this teaching, to be in the world, not of it. It's a very old Christian teaching. I can tell right now that everybody who's listening to him is going to want to avoid bargains, avoid attachments, avoid, you know, earthly goals. And that's not being free at all. To be running from something is not being free of it. And I think this is so important that it's well worth pausing this video, because this teaching is totally derailed if it becomes avoid this world. If you're avoiding this world, you're not free from it. The old teaching of the opposite of romantic love or you know, friendship love is not hate, it's indifference, is a pretty decent pointer here. So if you're running from it, you're just as attached to it as if you're running to it. If you're pushing or pulling, you are not free. Free is, it is what it is, and you let it be. So, if for some reason you're in some kind of really demented society where you can't go and pick fruit off of trees and eat, and there's a grocery store and they only accept money and you have to go somehow get that money and da-da-da-da-da-da, well, of course you can say, I'm anti that whole thing, and I live in the wilds with my friends and I carve pieces of wood and we're natural people. No, you're not. You're not natural at all. You're very unnatural because you're running from something. You're making a new artificial world. One based on your idea of what humans used to be like. Now, humans always have interacted with what their environment is. And if it was absent grocery stores, they didn't use them. It's not special to run from it or to run to it. The freedom he's talking about, being free of the world, is to accept the world as it is, without attachment to what you find.
Everything that would limit the mind to believe that it's in time and space, and soar into an experience of pure joy, which is transcendent, which is mystical, and which is our whole purpose, to see and experience ourselves as beyond this world. So with all the metaphors, I like that song. That's a good kickoff song. Only an instant does this world endure. Not something we generally heard at the kitchen table when we were growing up from mom and dad. Only an instant does this world endure. It was always about the future or the past. It was always deflecting away from the holy instant. All of our conditioning, everything we were raised with, the whole thing, we bought it hook, line, and sinker. A complete illusion that has nothing to do with reality whatsoever. And then we have to go into the holy instant. We have to have an experience of the holy instant to know that the separation never happened. It's just one instant, but it's like, what's it going to be? Holiness or sin and death? Which phase of the moment are we going to accept? It's not two moments, really. They aren't even side by side, because the Holy Spirit answered the belief in separation simultaneously as the belief arose. So it was that fast that we have to decide which.
Yeah, I like the pointers. I don't think the teacher gets it. Now, he's a rather joyous fellow. He certainly looks like a nice guy to be around. He's harvesting joy, he's harvesting love, and that's all great. But he still needs a lot of metaphors in order to induce him into the state of acceptance. He needs his Holy Spirit, he needs his Jesus, he needs it. This is really about ultimately leaving all of these pointers. If the pointers are still inducing you to do something, fine, those are great training wheels. But at some point, no. And I get he's a teacher. Trust me, I do this job for a living. It just feels like he's locked into this Christian theology thing, and it's limiting him. That's what it feels like to me.
Of those two interpretations, we value more. Innocence or guilt. And it's one instant. So the section from the Course that's coming to mind is the immediacy of salvation.
And I think the reason what I'm doing is because I've been around long enough. Like, most of my students, when I'm talking, are asleep. Right? So that's how I know I'm doing this right. His students are nodding and going, oh, yeah, oh. And that sound is mind. I know the sound. It's the mind acknowledging, oh, I'm going to put that in my back pocket and use that later as a tool. Oh, yes, 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 yes. And so I'd say his teaching is not effective. You want students who are asleep. You want them to be half awake like Matthew is right now. And the reason why I say that is because what seems to be engaged in his teaching is a mind saying, yes, I'm going to go back to noticing which present moment I want. And yes, I'm going to not sin. And I'm going to, there's a lot of huzzas and yeses going on in this. And I like what the metaphors he's using. They're not landing well. They're landing as tools. Maybe I'm just in a weird mood today, because this teaching is perfectly fine. I could give this out as homework. I certainly could. Maybe I'm just in a weird mood where I just want people to sit in the truth without narrative. Without a tool.
Where Jesus is saying, why would the good, he asks a question, he asks a direct question to the mind, why should the good appear in evil's form? Why should the good appear in evil's form? We watched this movie, God's Not Dead, and there's a black man from South Africa who's always saying, God is good. And always, God is, all the time, always, God is good. God is good. If we come into a non-dualistic goodness being love, God is love all the time. God is love. God is love. God is love. Why should the love appear in evil's form? Why should the good appear in evil's form? This is from the immediacy of salvation section, late in the text of the Course. Why should it take time to experience what you already are? Why should the good appear in evil's form? Why are there perceived difficulties around health or around finance?
I certainly hope he's getting to an answer pretty soon.
Or around the world, or around relationships, or around anything. Why should the good appear in evil's form? And then he follows up his question with another question. And is it not deception if it does? It's so deep. He's just saying, why should the good appear in evil's form? And is it not deception if it does?
I don't know if you guys are hearing it, but there's a lot of in his students. These metaphors are great. I think the question should be asked in reverse. Why shouldn't it? I think it's really time for students to tell me why there shouldn't be evil. Why is this an accepted truth? Because you'll hear me say casually a lot, what kind of game would this be without it? I say that and a lot of people laugh and nod. I mean it. What kind of game would this be without it? I'm perfectly willing to play that game where there's no evil and everyone's just sweet to each other. I am absolutely perfectly willing to play it, but that's apparently not what the goddess is here to do. It's her game. She's playing it. So, interestingly enough, the idea that evil shouldn't be is also part of the game that she's playing. We get to sit in judgment of God. Oh, you made a bad world, God. I did that. I just read the intro to one of my books where I was talking about a session where I was telling God that she was an idiot. Because if humanity is the best she can do, you gotta admit, she didn't do a great job. But if one wanted to be entertained by equal parts light and dark, she did a pretty damn good job. If she came here to see form from formless, split into equal parts light and dark, and she made humans, brava, fucking good job. Well done. These are the same humans who will sit on a Sunday sermon and then go and fucking molest their children in the middle of the night. I think that's amazing. Good job, Goddess. Highly entertaining.
No wonder he has less than 135. A healed mind is relieved of the belief that it must plan. No wonder he put the I need do nothing section in the book. A much misinterpreted piece in the book because it's interpreted from the ego lens of doing as if the doer is a fact. And now this doer need do nothing. This doer need only be. Well, this doer is a denial. What did Shakespeare teach us? To be or not to be? That is the question. I was saying that only an hour ago. And there was questions of whether it would be a wedding today or not. To be or not to be? That is the only question. This isn't a question of a wedding or no wedding. We have not come here to discuss such silly matters. We have not come for ceremonies. We have not come to play with little ideas, children's toys, and tinker around is to be, Shakespeare's question, to be or not to be is the question. And then Jesus is saying, why should the good appear in evil's form? He's sending us toward the be.
Yeah, this teaching has not reintegrated itself with reality. I can tell you this now. So, there is an actual useful phase where we disengage with relative experience. And it is extremely important to see that relative experience is an illusion. But the only thing interesting he talked about in this whole thing is the wedding ceremony. And that's the thing he dismissed as useless. Not because there's any meaning in a wedding ceremony. Not because there's anything useful in a wedding ceremony. But watching two people stand up and say, I love you, would be highly entertaining. Even if they divorce next Tuesday. I mean that, by the way. I'm not being facetious. It's kind of fun to see two people stand up and say, I love you. It's what we came here for. See, the reintegration back into relative consciousness that they talk about in Zen, he hasn't done. He's teaching from the space of being disconnected from the world. And monasteries were made for people who are in his stage. It's a fine stage. He's doing extremely well. I don't even have a problem with him having students. I would just like to see this man, and I mean this, mature. So that weddings aren't childish. Because all teachings are childish. All metaphors are useless. And if you're unable to sit in a wedding and watch two people say, I love you, and messed up about it, then your teaching isn't worth listening to. It has to be reintegrated back into the relative. And we do that by not running from it. Yes, we spent many years running to it, believing it, immersing ourselves in it, thinking it was important. Yes, so for a short while to say it's not important, it's not real, that's useful. But then if that now becomes my permanent philosophy, then I guess you need a cave and a wall somewhere or a monastery. You can see people in spiritual practices get stuck where he's pointing. You know, when the Buddha was sitting under a tree and eating, you know, whatever the fuck it was, four grains of rice, and then finally just had a whole bowl of rice, all of his ascetic followers left. Said, you're a false prophet. You're not starving yourself to death. We only follow someone who starves himself to death. You've lied to us. You've betrayed us by eating an entire bowl of rice. That's my teacher. I'll listen to somebody who eats the whole bowl of rice. Anyone starving themselves under a tree is a fool. But just one fucking bowl, you know? I mean, eat whatever it is that you need in this body, mind. Then the next crazy person is now stashing 10,000 grams, you know, of rice behind them for some future when they'll need it. Stop! You're going to die. You're going to suffer. Add that into your plan and you'll be fine. Now come back. Come back. Don't hide in the spiritual. Come back. Come back knowing it's fake. Come back with that wink. I'm going to play. The same way that people who aren't completely insane can play the game of Monopoly. If you're completely insane, well, then winning and losing in Monopoly is even important. But you can see the rational ones going, this money's fake. Why do I care if I win or not? Good for you. Good for you. You've seen past the illusion of the game of Monopoly. Bravo. Well done. That's his teaching. Now fucking play the game and shut up. Because you're there to be with the humans. You're there to have this experience all called playing games with your friends. So yes, if you took it very seriously, then noticing that it's not real is very useful. By all means, now shut up and roll the dice and move your dog. And by the way, be nice to the person on your left and the person on your right. This is useful spiritual teaching. Not, I will never play Monopoly again. No, don't believe it. I really hope this distinction is clear. If you're avoiding it, if you're running from it, you're just as attached to it.
He's not going to be content with the not to be. And who could, listen, lesson 139, I will accept atonement for myself in the course of the workbook lesson. He says, you are yourself. Of that there is no doubt.
You know, I think this is why I don't have a Bible. Because he's got to memorize lesson 139. He's got to... I really think that having one source book is a hindrance. He's got to spend all day referencing that one source book. I think this is the problem with being a Course in Miracles teacher, if you want my opinion. The teachers I listen to are the ones who are just speaking from direct experience. I wish he was more teaching from his own personal experience.
And yet, you doubt it. The only thing in the universe, the only thing in the universe that you cannot doubt is your identity, is who you are. That's the absolute only thing in the universe that's beyond doubt. And yet, you doubt it. Self-doubt is fear. Self-doubt is guilt. To deny who you are is the only thing. That's...
I certainly hope the next question is, what is the self? Because if he goes on, if he says that and he doesn't ask the next question, which is, what is the self? Because he's saying, don't deny the self. I'm fine with that. But what is the self? Because he's got an entire audience full of people who are going to say that their self is this feeling I've always had in my stomach, this story of me. Let me tell you the story of me. That's their self.
That's how the song ends. We would go beyond this instant to eternity, to identity, 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 eternity, eternity, eternity. You know, it's an intense song because it's like eternity sending out a plea to say, remember me, remember me. That's all in the Lion King. That's what Simba's father says from the clouds. Remember, remember, we have an identity. Don't get caught in the Pride Land. Don't get caught in Hakuna Matata eating bugs. You know, it's not, it's, you may think it's a good life. You're not working when you're eating bugs, but still, remember, don't be content with the bugs.
Yeah, I absolutely get this teaching. I do not think he's a skillful teacher. A bunch of people just left his Satsang saying that their self is important and walking around talking about how important their self is. So, the general teaching is you are not of this world. That's the general teaching that he's espousing in this. It's not a bad teaching. It's an old teaching. It's meant to be a transition teaching. Hold on, I'm going to turn off the stop sharing. It's meant to be a transition teaching. It's not meant to be the final destination. Now, if I'm taking the real world seriously, I need a healthy dose of this teaching. See? If I think the real world is important and that what happens on this little planet is important, and certainly what happens to this thing here, this little me here, is important, then this is a fucking useful, unbelievably useful teaching. It is temporary. Because when I say come back to play Monopoly, I don't say come back and believe you're the dog. I say play the fucking game. Don't come back believing you're the dog and that the money is real and that the winner somehow gets something. Because let me tell you, they don't. Play the game. Play with these people you're with. This is the part that when I say that the goddess is playing with her little dollies and having a tea party, and the goddess doesn't mind if Dolly A and Dolly B get in an argument. I don't like you. You're never nice to me. I never liked your parents. They're assholes. Oh, you never loved me. The goddess is having a blast. Join her. That's playing. That's coming back to play. There is a reintegration phase that you'll see. And honestly, if there isn't one, then I always ask myself, it's a nice teaching, but this person's not quite baked yet. Which is why Matthew can tell you that Mark Pifer, as a human being, because he lived here for a year, is not that interesting. He farts, he poops, he plays video games. Makes really bad French jokes, and that's about it. It's not really exciting, as all of you who have spent any time around me know, this is not very exciting. Because I'm back. Had you guys met me, and Jill hung out a little bit with me while I was floating in the stars, it might have looked a little bit like, I don't know, spiritual. But I'm back. I'm back. I'm right back in the middle of all this insanity. I take none of it seriously. But when my 49ers lost, I fucking threw a fit. I called the refs a bunch of blind assholes. And I said, only my team gets bad calls against them. No other team gets bad calls. And I knew I was saying bullshit. But why, you can't watch a football game unless you're going to choose one side and make that side important. You can watch it just for the technical interest in it, I guess. It's not as fun. You want to pick a side. And the Cowboys are evil. I mean, that is just well-known fact. You gotta play. But if I was watching, and Rick's a Cowboy fan, that's why I'm playing with him. But if I was watching a game, 49ers versus Cowboys, and Rick was in the room, and Rick was suffering because he was invested in the game, I would have to incorporate that in how I played the game, too. Because Rick is who I'm watching the game with. See? Don't forget what the fuck you're doing. You're here to play. So if the person in your sandbox is not enjoying the game, well then, change the game. And you can do that when you know that the game isn't important. If the game was important, then I turn to Rick and I'd say, well, then you have to suffer because you've chosen the Dallas Cowboys and they're evil, which you have, and that's a bad idea. But if he really was suffering, I'd turn the fucking thing off. Or, and I hope that only 5 people ever watch this video, I'd go and put the Dallas Cowboys stuff on and root for his team. Because Rick would be important. This is the teaching that Richard finally got through my fat fucking head. He said, the person you're talking to is real. Not the subject matter. Can you imagine political discourse in this country if that was the rule? But you can't get there if you're defending an abstract self that is the downtrodden one. And then somebody says, I'm a Republican and my victim story is greater than yours. And you say, I'm a Democrat. Mine is greater than yours. And the two people are comparing boo-boos. And I hear this all the time. You hear this in political discourse. Oh, white male people, they don't have the ability to suffer. Yeah, they do. Black people, they're lazy. Blah, 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 blah. No, they're not. They're just people. So-and-so wants to take away that. No, they just want their children cared for. Do you want your children cared for? Well, yeah. Well, then you don't actually disagree with this person you're talking to. If you can see through the bullshit and see the human you're talking to, all that crap just dissolves. If Donald Trump really was standing in front of me, even though I find him to be politically absolutely toxic, and he was crying and truly miserable, then that is what I would address. I wouldn't take the time to kick him in the balls. I would say, hey, Donald, looks like you're in pain. He'd say, yep. I say that, I'm sorry to see that. Can you imagine what compassion might do to an actual discussion? And I would say, oh, you're so Christ-like, Mark. No, I just happen to know for a fact that while I'm willing to play the game as a liberal, it's bullshit. I am politically liberal. I believe that at this particular point in history, I've said this many times and people don't get it, liberalism is going to bring us back to the center. Because I think we are way far into this insane right. And the right is saying we're too left. Interesting. But I'm looking at it and I see that between the two right now, while the left is insanely destructive, the right is a little bit more destructive. They're both destructive. And I just want as little destruction as possible. When my liberal friends see me vote Republican one day because the liberals have gone crazy, then they'll say I've abandoned them. But right now, all political discourse that I see is my boo-boo's bigger than your boo-boo, and nobody sees the person they're talking to. Well, then you need some more work. If you're defending your abstract concept against their abstract concept, then it'd be nice for you to take this man's advice and leave this plane of existence as an identity. The talk we just listened to that I seem to be poo-pooing is literally medicine for 99.99% of the people on this planet. Should be handed out as mandatory medicine. This talk that I seem to be poo-pooing. And it's temporary. Okay. Thank you for whoever gave me the talk. Oh, Mathieu, did I respond well to your talk, or did I crap all over it? You good? Okay. We got 20 minutes left, and we got Nisargadatta. And where am I supposed to pause this?
Start at 4:06.
4 minutes and 6 seconds?
Uh-huh.
And go to?
8:20.
4 minutes and 6 seconds to 8:20. We can do that. This is rare, Nisargadatta talk.
Would Maharaj talk about the grace of the guru?
Oh, okay. So this isn't him talking. This is someone talking for him.
Baby says it's because they're usually hard to hear him.
Oh, it's stunningly hard to hear him.
Yeah, so.
He has a very thick accent. And he's not mic'd well because he's in a room. So the very few talks I've seen of his are very hard to follow. Okay, again, we will share the screen.
Turn the sound on first.
Okay. So 4:06 to 8 something?
20.
Okay. Here we go. We are prior to consciousness, Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj. And we're off. We're 4 minutes and 6 seconds into this video.
Or worldly pursuits. April 8th, 1980. Is the world as we see it a thought? It is written in some places that when one sees the world, one does not see the self. And conversely, when one sees the self, one does not see manifestation.
Wow! This is exactly the same talk. That we just heard.
The world is nothing but the picture of your own I consciousness. As if you had received a phone call telling you that you are, and immediately the world appears. When you are in deep sleep and you feel that you are awake, the dream world appears simultaneously. With the I am, the world appears in the waking and dream states. Can one see the world without the presence of the ego? When there is an ego, the ego is there when you have certain reactions. You take delivery of whatever is observed spontaneously. You cling to it, register it, then only is there an ego.
That's fucking, not shockingly, brilliant. Because this guy is teaching from that space. The thing reacting, the thing pushing and pulling. That's the ego. So, what is this world without that? Look for yourself. My father's dead. And yet, the world kept going. And that's the part of it that the left hemisphere screams, God damn it! There's something concrete happening here. Because if my father's dead, and the world kept going after he's dead, well then, how do I explain to my father who he was in relation to that thing that kept going? So why should the left hemisphere give up playing this game that's obviously real? I'm not going to listen to the spiritual teacher. I got to go get mine. Gimme, 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 hubba, hubba. And not that, not that, not that, not that. Gimme, 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 not that, not that. Gimme, 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 not that, not that. Push, pull, push, pull, push, pull. What would it be like if that wasn't there? Interestingly enough, it would be the same as my father, wouldn't it? The shit would just go on. When you die spiritually before your actual body death, you notice the same thing I can notice about my father, which is my father died and nothing stopped. I stopped pushing and pulling and nothing stopped. Therefore, it's the pushing and pulling that's the illusion. It's all my grasping that's the illusion. You know, there have been kings that have literally, you could talk about the pyramids, though they're, quote, still standing. So we won't use the pyramids because people would argue that this would be contrary to that. But they've built these huge castles and they've gone about all this stuff and they've murdered and there's tons of blood for them to get their kingdom in order and have it safe and their borders safe. And then you just wait 100 years and it's all fucking meaningless. All that death, all that blood, all that hell, all that suffering for nothing. The end result is nothing. So they do things like, we are Russia. We need to attack Ukraine. And they do it again. And then, we are Britain. We need to defend. They do this forever. Defending abstract ideas, abstract concepts, and total and utter bullshit. Because some of these countries have actually disappeared. Certainly some of these, you don't hear people talk about Babylonia anymore. But it was really important to the kings of Babylonia. All this pushing and pulling is the illusion. Because whatever this thing is, whatever this bullshit play of form is, that we can call real. Just as God. That's how I use the term, the pantheistic term. God playing with form. So God is the void and the form with which inside it plays. All of it. The pushing and pulling is the illusion. And the pusher and puller causes suffering.
You see some building material lying on the road? You think that you are a carpenter, and you start figuring out how to use that material. The thought process has started. Ego starts. If you are nobody, you will not bother about the building material. You will just observe it and go your way. Once it is out of sight, it is out of mind. But when you receive that delivery, you cogitate over it. Ego has started. So when it comes to the utility of what is seen, that's when the ego comes into being? Yes, that is its nature. To get back to my other question, when the world is seen, the self is not. When the self is seen, the world is not. Is that so? It is the other way. When you know that you are, the world is. If you are not, the world is not. Is I the self? I am talking about the difference between the I am and the thought, I am a man, which is the ego. In the I am the consciousness, does the world exist? Can you see it? When you wake up, you have only the sense of being, without words. This is the primary principle, the prerequisite. Later on, you know fully that you are and the world is, but that is an illusion, like the horns of a hare. The world is like the dream world, finally. Understand this point very thoroughly. You are dealing too much with the ego. Have you?
So, let me see if I can put this another way. People ask me, why is the ego fake? So I have one individual POV experience of seeing the pile of wood he's talking about. What's happening literally on the opposite side of the world from me. Do I know? This is extremely important point. Even Matthew should wake up. If I don't know what's happening on the other side of the world, because I'm having a POV experience, does that exclude that something's happening on the other side of the world? That alone should just tell you the POV experience is an illusion. That should be enough. Honestly, that one insight, that me looking down at this singular experience I'm having, but I can't see what's happening either behind me or even 500 yards away from me, should be enough to dismiss that the singular POV experience is real. Because as I just said, my dad died and it all kept going. Now, if I'm staring at the wood and there's a panther behind me and the panther kills me, maybe I should have been looking for a panther. This POV experience is the illusion. And he said utility, which is exactly it. The left hemisphere of your brain is trying to say, will this enhance me? If I believe that process is real, that there is a me separate from everything else that needs to be placed in a higher position than the rest of it, then I have generated an illusion, which is called an ego. Because you're not. You're not better or worse. That's also the victim story, is I'm worse than everything. Nope. I don't understand the question, Rick. You said unreal or limited. Say again. Oh, I think I understand. Is the ego experience unreal? Or is it simply limited? Okay. Because it's limited, it can't be real. You're not seeing the truth. So, this goes back, this is literally circling all the way back to the original conversation about from the previous one. First, I see it's not real. And then I say, well, why should I play in the unreal? Well, you haven't answered, why shouldn't I? You have to answer that. You have to explain to me why you shouldn't play in the real. What are you avoiding? If I give you the game Pac-Man, and I tell you that you're the little waka 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 thing eating, and you're not the ghosts, well, if somebody comes along and says, you know what? You're neither. That's a video game. They're right. Correct? So if you're taking the game seriously, that might be something useful to notice. But then put your quarter in and waka 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 waka. It is fake. Interestingly enough, the experience of it without any bullshit any attached to it, the I, the singular me, some concept of me, and even those are also goddess having real experiences. That's why ultimately you can't separate anything. Because even me sitting in egoic consciousness suffering horribly is exactly what she came here to play. That's the final bit where you have a shift in consciousness and you run out to tell everybody and you think, why should I ruin their good time? She came here to be miserable. Who am I to tell her not to be? which is why my teacher had the wisdom to tell me don't preach. Not my job to go tell everybody that the Pac-Man game is not real. When they come to me and they say playing Pac-Man is causing me to suffer, then I can point out it's not real because they want to know. But then after that, if they haven't gone back and put the quarter back in and started playing again, then I have kind of done them a disservice because now I'm giving them a new avoidance strategy. Don't have to play Pac-Man. Play anything. That's what you're here to do.
Understood what was said about the ego? I think I have. If I ask another question, maybe I can resolve it. Using the analogy of the snake and the rope, seeing a rope in a dimly lit place and mistaking it for a snake. If we use the world in that analogy, where is the mistaken identity there? The self is the world. You're talking about removing the identity between the self and the world, aren't you? First of all, dispose of the self. Understand what the self is. Get to know the self first, then get to know what the world is. The reason the world appeared is that you came to know that you are. How can one in the waking state lose the sensation of the world altogether and just be the self? You will have to consult the sun and ask him, how did you get rid of your light? Light is the manifestation of the sun. Can you separate the light from the sun or the sun from the light? Because of the sun, the light is. Because you are, your world is. Because the witnessing state happens, hence you are. Because you are, witnessing is palpably felt. Because the sun is, light is. If there is no witnessing, where is the witness? Dwell there. The being is the witness. There are two witnessing stages. Beingness witnesses all this manifestation. Witnessing of this beingness, consciousness, happens to that eternal principle, the absolute.
Yeah. Now he's using terms that if you're not familiar with his teachings, you might sound like absolute relative. You know, I use a lot of the same terms, so if you're around me, it'll make sense. But let me ask you something, and this is for you guys to look at. Are you having this human experience or not? Don't listen to me. So, Matthew's having the human experience of sleeping. And it is. It's one of the things we came here to do. So if you're having it, if it exists, if it arises as an experience, then we can call it real. We can call it a real experience. For some reason, people don't get hung up on this when they're watching a movie. And so the movie is used a lot as an analogy. Right? You're watching a movie and you get caught up in the plot. And somebody says, hey, you know, that's not a real shark. And then even goes on to say, you know, Spielberg really struggled with that shark. And you're like, shut the fuck up, man. I'm watching Jaws. Yeah, but I want to tell you trivia that I know. Shut up. For some reason, people get hung up when the credits roll going, they lied to me. It was fake. Those are actors. They don't have a problem with this. In fact, they go and pay a ticket to go to the next. There's a new Spielberg movie out. I don't even know what the fuck it is. They line up again for the same experience. So why wouldn't the goddess? Don't you see that you have the same interest she does because you are her? So if you want to create a movie called Me, the Horrible, Tortured Human, who had this problem and this problem. She's highly entertained. Because she knows nothing real can be harmed. That's why we go to movies where they have these huge alien invasions and the whole world's blowing up and humans are all exploding because we're not. I'm here with my soda and my popcorn. I'm having a great time. How entertaining. What makes you think that she's not doing the exact same thing with you? So the question is, are you done? Because most of the people I teach aren't. They're not done. They want to be this miserable self. Cool. You're not breaking the rules, man. You're in fact playing the game exactly the way the goddess wants to play. The only question in spiritual practice is, are you done? Are you done? Because if you're done, you're in luck, it's fake. Not important. What if I sit in a cave and do not feed myself? You will either starve or some crazy person will come up and say, like they did to Ramana Maharshi, well, you must be deep, and they feed you. The great teachers that went off into a cave and starved and died, you know, we probably don't have their books. But I guarantee you, they didn't have any problem. Because I've been there. I've been to the place where I don't give a shit if I die. As long as I stay in this open, connected love that I have found by letting go. Are you kidding me? I don't give a shit. Kill me. Which is why the ascetics thought that Buddha was such a fake. Because you should be able to be nurtured by it. Well, you can be. You can also eat a fucking bowl of rice. Not one or the other is better. This is the ultimate truth and why the Buddha is a deeper, more mature teacher than the ascetic just looking for bliss and nothing else. Because the Buddha said, why is the bliss not in the bowl of rice? Why do I have to push against one or pull against the other? Which seems to be the theme of these talks today. Even the inner child one. If you want to keep your inner child miserable and horribly in this little cage so that you can create a persona and tell people at parties that you're the one that's downtrodden and people go, there, you poor thing. Knock yourself out. Are you done with it? Because if you're not, shoot, go for it. Highly entertaining to the goddess either way. So, baby, did I answer your question about Nisargadatta? He's here, I guess, but I can't see him. Mm-hmm. To be in the world, but not of it.
Yes, you did. Thank you.
You're very welcome. To be in the world, but not of it, does not mean to run from it. Notice the first part is to be in it. It's an engaged suggestion. To be in it, not of it, is the balance that you find when you ultimately master this. It's kind of like when I was working on becoming a movie creator. Movies were ruined for a long time. You guys get that in Tenuous Mind, don't you? When I started looking at how to make a movie, I couldn't watch a movie. And now that all of the interworkings of my ego, I've been looking at it and deconstructing it. It's kind of hard to go out in ego. I don't know what to say at a dinner party when somebody says, "What do you do?" I'm not functioning anymore. And then you get an answer and you start playing again. All of my answers, including the past 2 hours of blah blah, are all wink, 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 wink. Trust me. All of my answers are bullshit. The quiet, absolute stillness and love is the truth. That's it. Everything else is just me playing the game of teacher, as if there's such a thing. All right. We are interrupting Matthew's nap, so we need to call this. I will entertain any questions based on what I've said, if any exist. If not, then we will call this. Seriously, I started a little late. Yes, go ahead, baby.
Sorry, I was waving goodbye.
Oh, bye. Go be in the world, but not of it. Love you. Bye.
Love you, bye.
Bye. And that, as they say,